This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book, Nothing But the Truth by Frederic S. Isham. Chapter 1, The Temerity of Bob. It can't be done. Of course it can. A man couldn't survive the ordeal. Could do it myself. The scene was the university club. The talk spread over a good deal of space, as talk will when pink cocktails or green gardens in a glass confront or are in front of the talkies. Dickie said it couldn't be done, and Bob said it was possible and that he could do it. He might not have felt such confidence had it not been for the verdant stimulation. He could have done anything just then, so why not this particular feat or stunt? And who was this temerarious one, and what was he like? As an excellent specimen of a masculine young animal, genus homo, Bob Bennett was good to look on. Some of those young ladies who wave banners when young men strain their backs and their arms and their legs in the cause of learning had in the days of the not-remote past dubbed him Sub Rosa, the Blue-Eyed Apollo. Some of the fellows not so euphemistically inclined had, however, during that same glorious period, found frequent occasion to refer to him less classically, if more truthfully, as that darn fool Bob Bennett. That was on account of a streak of wildness in him, for he was a free, bold creature, was Bob. Conventional bars and gates chafed him. He may have looked like a blue-eyed Apollo, but his spirit had the wings of a wild goose, than which there are no faster birds, for a wild goose is the biplane of the Empyrean. Now that Bob had ceased the chase for learning and was out in the wide world, he should have acquired an additional sobriquet, that of impecunious Bob. It would have fitted his pecuniary condition very nicely. Once he had had great expectations, but alas, Dad had just come a cropper. They had sheared him on the street. The world in general didn't know about it yet, but Bob did. "We're broke, Bob," said Dad that very morning. "That's all right, government," said Bob. "Can you get up?" "I can't even procure a pair of crutches to hobble with," answered Dad. "Never mind," observed Bob magnanimously. "You've done pretty well by me up to date. Don't you worry or reproach yourself. I'm not going to heap abuse on those gray hairs." "Thanks, Bob." "Coolie. I'm not worrying. You see, it's up to you now."
"Me?"
Bob stared. "Yes. You see, I believe in the Japanese method."
"What's that?"
Uneasily. "Duty of a child to support his parent, when said child is grown up." Bob whistled. "Say, government, do you mean it?"
"Gospel truth, Bob."
Bob whistled again.
"Not joking?"
"'Pon honor."
Cheerfully.
"I never did like the Japanese," from Bob, sotto voce. "Blame lot of heathens, that's what they are. I've got a dollar or two that I owe tucked away where no one can find it except me," went on Dad, unmindful of Bob's little soliloquy. "That will have to last until you come to the rescue."
"Gee. I'm glad you were thoughtful enough for that," ejaculated the young man.
"Sure you can keep it hidden."
"Burglars couldn't find it," said Dad confidently, "let alone my creditors, God bless them.
But it won't last long, Bob. Bear that in mind. It'll be a mighty short respite."
"Oh, I'll not forget it. If it's not an impertinence, may I ask what you are going to do, Dad?"
"I'm contemplating a fishing trip first of all, and after that," Queen sighed. "Some pleasure suitable to my retired condition will undoubtedly suggest itself. I may take up the study of philosophy. Confucius has always interested me. They say it takes 40 years to read him, and then 40 years to digest what you have read. The occupation would, no doubt, prove adequate. But don't concern yourself about that, dear boy. I'll get on. You owe me a large debt of gratitude. I'm thrusting a great responsibility on you. It should be the making of you."
Bob had his secret doubts.
"Get out and hustle, dear boy. It's up to you now." And he spread out his hands in carefree fashion and smiled blandly.
No Buddha could have appeared more complacent, only instead of a lotus flower, Bob's dad held in his hand a long black weed, the puffing of which seemed to afford a large measure of ecstatic satisfaction. Go. He waved the free hand. My blessing on your efforts. Bob started to go, and then he lingered. Perhaps, he said, you can tell me what I am going to do. Don't know. Cheerfully. What can I do? Hopelessly. Couldn't say. I don't know anything. Ha ha. Dad laughed, as if son had sprung a joke. Well, that is a condition experience will remove. Experience and hard knocks, he added. Bob swore softly. His head was humming. No heroic purpose to get out and fight his way moved him. He didn't care about shoveling earth or chopping down trees. He had no frenzied desire to brave the 60 below zero temperature of the Klondike in a mad search for gold. In a word, he didn't feel at all like the heroes in the books who conquer under almost impossible conditions in the vastnesses of the open, and incidentally wallop a few Herculean simple-minded sons of nature just to prove that breed is better than brawn. Of course, I could give you a little advice, Bob, said the governor softly. If you should find hustling a bit arduous for one of your luxurious nature, there's an alternative. It is always open to a young man upon whom nature has showered her favors. Don't know what you mean by that last, growled Bob, who disliked personalities. But what is the alternative to hustling? Get married, said Dad coolly. Bob changed color. Dad watched him keenly. There's always the matrimonial market for young men who have not learned to specialize. I've known many such marriages to turn out happily, too. Marrying right, my boy, is a practical, not a sentimental business. Bob looked disgusted. There's Miss Gwendolyn Gerald, for example. Millions in her own name, and... Hold on, Dad, cried Bob. His face was flaming now. The blue eyes gleamed almost fiercely. I knew you were acquainted, observed Dad softly, still studying him. Besides, she's a beautiful girl, and... Drop it, Dad, burst from Bob. We've never had a quarrel, but... Suddenly, he realized his attitude was actually menacing. And toward Dad, his own dad. I beg your pardon, sir, he muttered contritely. I'm afraid I am forgetting myself. But please turn the talk. All right, said Dad. I forgive you. I was only trying to elucidate your position. But since it's not to be the matrimonial market, it'll have to be a hustle, my boy. I'm too old to make another fortune. I've done my bit, and now I'm going to retire on my son. Sounds fair and equitable, doesn't it, Bob? I'd hate to contradict you, sir, the other answered moodily. Dad walked up to him and laid an arm affectionately upon son's broad shoulders. I've the utmost confidence in you, my boy, he said with a bland smile. Thank you, sir, replied Bob. He always preserved an attitude of filial respect toward his one and only parent. But he tore himself away from Dad now as soon as he could. He wanted to think. The average hero, thrust out into the world, has only a single load to carry. He has only to earn a living for himself. Bob's load was a double one, and therefore he would have to be a double hero. Mechanically he walked on and on, cogitating upon his unenviable fate. Suddenly he stopped. He found himself in front of the club. Bob went in. And there he met Dickie, Clarence, Dan the Doughty Commodore, and some others. That impecunious Bob should have said, it could be done, to Imperial Dickie's it couldn't, and have allowed himself to be drawn further into the affair was in itself an impertinence. For Dickie was a person of importance. He had a string of simoleons so long that a newspaper mathematician once computed, if you spread them out, touching one another, they would reach half around the world. Or was it twice around? Anyhow, Dickie didn't have to worry about hustling the way Bob did now. At the moment, the latter was in a mood to contradict anyone. He felt reckless. He was ready for almost anything, short of an imitation of that back-to-nature hero of a popular novel. They had been going on about that could and couldn't proposition for some time when someone staked Bob. That someone was promptly called by the Commodore, as jolly a sea dog as never trod a deck. Dan was a land commodore, but he was very popular at the yacht club, where something besides waves seethed when he was around. He didn't go often to the university club, where he complained things were too pedagogic. No one else ever complained of that. He liked to see the decks or floors wave. Then he was in his element, and would issue orders with the blithe abandon of a son of Neptune. There was no delay in clapping on sail when the Commodore was at the helm. And if he said, "Clear the decks for action," there was action. When he did occasionally drift into the university, he brought with him the flavor of the sea. Things at once breezed up. Well, the Commodore called that someone quick. 5,000, he can't do it. "For how long?" says Dickie. "A week," answered the Commodore. "Make it 2. "Oh, very well. 3 if you like," from Bob the Stormy Petrel. They gazed at him admiringly. "It isn't the Green Garden talking, is it, Bob?" asked Clarence Van Dusen, whose sole occupation was being a director in a few corporations, or more strictly speaking, not being one. It took almost all Clarence's time to direct his wife, or try to. Bob looked at Clarence reproachfully. "No," he said. "I'm still master of all my thoughts." Gloomily. "I couldn't forget if I tried." "That's all right then," said Dickie. Then Clarence took someone else who staked Bob. And Dickie did likewise. And there was some more talk. And then Bob staked himself. "Little short of cash at the bank just now," he observed. "But if you'll take my note." "Take your word if you want," said the Commodore. "No, here's my note." He gave it a large amount payable in 30 days. It was awful, but he did it. He hardly thought what he was doing. Having the utmost confidence he would win, he didn't stop to realize what a large contract he was taking on. But Dan, Dickie, Clarence, and the others did. "Of course you can't go away and hide," said Dickie to Bob with sudden suspicion. "No, you can't do that," from Clarence. "Or get yourself arrested and locked up for 3 weeks. That wouldn't be fair, old chap." "Bob understands he's got to go on in the even tenor of his way," said the Commodore. Bob nodded. "Just as if nothing had happened," he observed. "I'll not seek or I'll not shirk. I'm on honor, you understand." "That's good enough for me," said Dickie. "Bob's honest." "And me," from Clarence. "And me," from half a dozen other good souls, including the non-aqueous Commodore. "Gentlemen, I thank you," said Bob, affected by this outburst of confidence. "I thank you for this display of this display. Cut it. Cork it up. And speaking of corks, when does it begin?" interrupted Bob. "When you walk out of here." "At the front door?" "When your foot touches the sidewalk, son." The Commodore, who was about 40 in years, sometimes assumed the paternal. "Never mind the son." Bob shuddered. "One father at a time, please." And then hastily, not to seem ungracious, "I've got such a jolly good real dad, you understand?" The Commodore dropped the paternal. "Well, lads, here's a bumper to Bob," he said. "We see his finish." "No doubt of that." "To Bob. Good old Bob. Ho ho." "Ha ha," said Bob funereally. Then he got up. "Going?" "Might as well." The Commodore drew out a watch. 12 minutes after 3 p.m. Monday, the 12th of September in the year of our Lord, 1813, he said. "You are all witnesses of the time the ball was opened?" "We are." "Goodbye, Bob." "Oh, let's go with him away." "Might be interesting," from Clarence sardonically. "It might. Least we can do is to see him start on his way rejoicing." "That's so," "Come on," which they did. Bob offered no objection. He didn't much care at the time whether they did or not. What would happen would. He braced himself for the inevitable. End of the chapter. Chapter 2, A Tryout. To tell the truth, to blurt out nothing but the truth to everyone, and on every occasion, for 3 whole weeks, that's what Bob had contracted to do. From the point of view of the Commodore and the others, the man who tried to fill this contract would certainly be shot, or electrocuted, or ridden out of town on a rail, or receive a coat of tar and feathers. And Bob had such a wide circle of friends, too, which would make his task the harder. The handsome dog was popular. He was asked everywhere that was anywhere, and he went too. He would certainly get his. The jovial Commodore was delighted. He would have a whole lot of fun at Bob's expense. Wasn't the latter the big boob, though? And wouldn't he be put through his paces? Really, it promised to be delicious. The Commodore and the others went along with Bob just for a little tryout. At first, nothing especially interesting happened. They walked without meeting anyone they were acquainted with. Transients, transients, where did they all come from? Once on their progress down the avenue, the hopes of Bob's friends rose high. A car they knew got held up on a side street not far away from them. It was a gorgeous car, and it had a gorgeous occupant, but a grocery wagon was between them and it. The Commodore warbled blithely. "Come on, Bob. Time for a word or two." But handsome Bob shook his head. "The even tenor of his way," he quoted. "I don't ordinarily go popping in and out between wheels like a rabbit. I'm not looking to commit suicide." "Oh, I only wanted to say, how do you do?" retorted the Commodore rather sulkily. "Or may I tango with you at tea this afternoon, Mrs. Ralston? Or observe how young she looks today, E.H. Bob?" murmured that young gentleman suspiciously. "Artful. Artful." Clarence poked the Commodore in the ribs. "Sly old sea dog." "Well, let's move on," yawned Dickie. "Nothing doing here." "Wait." The Commodore had an idea. "Hi, you young grocery lad, back up a little, will you?" "What for?" said the boy, aggressive at once. "Babes are born in New York with chips on their shoulders. As a matter of trifling accommodation, that is all," answered the Commodore sweetly. "On the other side of you is a stately car, and we would hold conversation with. Agwan. Guess I got as much right to the street as it has." And as a display of his rights, he even touched up his horse a few inches to intervene more thoroughly. "Perhaps now for $0.50, began the Commodore more insinuatingly. Then he groaned, "Too late." The policeman had lifted the ban. The stately car turned into the avenue and was swallowed up amid a myriad of more or less imposing vehicles. They had, however, received a bow from the occupant. That was all there had been opportunity for. Incidentally, the small boy had bestowed upon them his parting compliments. "Smart old guy. You think yaus," the rest was jumbled up or lost in the usual cacophony of the thoroughfare. "Too bad," murmured the Commodore. "But still, these 3 weeks are young." "3 weeks," observed Dickie. "Sounds like plagiarism." "Oh, Bob won't have that kind of a 3 weeks," snickered Clarence. "Bob's will be an expurgated edition," from the Commodore, recovering his spirits. "Maybe we ought to make it 4. 3 will do," said Bob, who wasn't enjoying this chaffing. Everyone they approached, he now eyed apprehensively. But he was a joy-giver, if not receiver, for his tall, handsome figure attracted many admiring glances. His striking head with its blonde curls, they weren't exactly curls, only his hair wasn't straight, but clung rather wavy-like to the bold contour of his head, his careless stride, and that general effect of young masculinity, all this caused sundry humble feminine hearts to go pit-a-pat. Bob's progress, however, was generally followed by pit-a-pats from shop girls and bonnet-bearers. Especially at the noon hour. Then Bob seemed to these humble toilers like dessert, after hard-boiled eggs, stale sandwiches, and pickles. But Bob was quite unaware of any approving glances cast after him. He was thinking, and thinking hard. He wasn't so sanguine now as he had been when he had left the club. What might have happened at that street corner appealed to him with sudden, poignant force. Mrs. Ralston was of the creme de la creme. She was determined to stay young. She pretended to be 30 years or so younger than she was. In fact, she was rather a ridiculous old lady who found it hard to conceal her age. Now what if the Commodore had found opportunity to ask that awful question? Bob could have made only one reply and told the truth. The largeness of his contract was becoming more apparent to him. He began to see himself now from Dan's standpoint. Incidentally, he was beginning to develop a great dislike for that genial land mariner. How about the Waldorf? They had paused at the corner of 34th Street. May find someone there, suggested Clarence. In Peekaboo Alley? Scornfully from Dicky. Oh, I heard there was a concert or something upstairs, said Clarence. In that you've got to be introduced room. And some of the real people have to walk through to get to it. Accordingly, they entered the Waldorf, and the Commodore hustled them up and down and around, without, however, their encountering a single real person. There were only people present, loads of them, not from somewhere but from everywhere. They did the circuit several times, still without catching sight of a real person. Phew! This is a lonesome place, breathed the Commodore at last. Let's depart, disgustedly from Clarence. Apologize for steering you into these barren wastes. What's your hurry? Said Bob, with a little more bravado. Then suddenly, he forgot about those other three. His entranced gaze became focused on one. He saw only her. Ha! The Commodore's quick glance, following Bob's, caught sight too of that wonderful face in the distance, the stunning, glowing young figure, that regal dream of just budded girlhood, that superb vision in a lovely afternoon gown. She was followed by one or two others. One could only imagine her leading. There would, of course, always be several at her either side, and quite a number dangling behind. Her lips were like the red rosebuds that swung negligently from her hand as she floated through the crowd. Her eyes suggested veiled dreams amid the confusion and hubbub of a topsy-turvy world. She was like something rhythmical precipitated amid chaos. A faraway impression of a smile played around the corners of her proud lips. The Commodore precipitated himself in her direction. Bob put out a hand as if to grasp him by the coattails, but the other was already beyond reach, and Bob's hand fell to his side. He stood passive. That was his part. Only he wasn't passive inwardly. His heart was beating wildly. He could imagine himself with her and them, those others in her train, and the conversation that would ensue, for he had no doubt of the Commodore's intentions. Dan was an adept at rounding up people. Bob could see himself at a table participating in the conversation, prepared conversation, some of it. He could imagine the Commodore leading little rivulets of talk into certain channels for his benefit. Dan would see to it that they would ask him, Bob, questions, embarrassing ones. That advice Dad had given him weighed on Bob like a nightmare. Suppose, ghastly thought, truth compelled him ever to speak of that? And to her. A shiver ran down Bob's backbone. Nearer she drew nearer, while Bob gazed as if fascinated, full of rapturous, paradoxical dread. Now the Commodore was almost upon her when... Ah, what was that? An open elevator? People going in. She too, those with her, yes, click, a closed door. The radiant vision had vanished, was going upward. Bob breathed again. Think of being even paradoxically glad at witnessing her disappear. Bob ceased now to think, stood as in a trance. Why do people go to concerts? Said the Commodore in aggrieved tones. Some queen that. And got the rocks or stocks from Dicky. Owns about three of those railroads that are going a-begging nowadays. "Wake up, Bobby," someone now addressed that abstracted individual. Bob shook himself. "Old friend of yours, Miss Gwendolyn Gerald, I believe," said the Commodore significantly. "Yes, I've known Miss Gerald for some time," said Bob coldly. "Known for some time," mimicked the Commodore. "Phlegmatic dog. Well, what shall we do now?"
"Hang around until the concert's over," suggested Dickie.
"Hang around nothing," said the Commodore. "It's one of those classical high jinks." Disgustedly. "Lasts so late the sufferers haven't time for anything after it's over. Just enough energy left to stagger to their cars and fall over in a comatose condition. Suppose we could go to the bar?"
"Naughty. Naughty,"
a sprightly voice interrupted. The Commodore wheeled. "Mrs. Ralston," he exclaimed gladly. It was the gorgeous lady of the gorgeous car.
"Just finished my shopping and thought I'd have a look in here," she said vivaciously.
"Concert, I suppose," from the Commodore jubilantly.
"Yes.
Debussy.
Don't you adore Debussy?"
with schoolgirlish enthusiasm. Though almost 60, she had the manners of a just come out.
"Nothing like it," lied the Commodore.
"Ah, then you too are a modern?" gushed the lady.
"I'm so advanced," said the Commodore, "I can't keep up with myself."
They laughed.
"Ah, silly man," said the lady's eyes.
Bob gazed at her and the Commodore enviously.
Oh, to be able once more to prevaricate like that.
The Commodore had never heard Debussy in his life. Ragtime and merry hornpipes were his limits. And Mrs. Ralston was going to the concert, it is true, but to hear the music?
Ah, no.
Her box was a fashionable rendezvous, and from it she could study modernity in hats. Therein, at least, she was a modern of the moderns. She was so advanced, the styles had fairly to trot or turkey trot to keep up with her.
"Well," she said, with that approving glance women usually bestowed upon Bob, "I suppose I mustn't detain you busy people after that remark I overheard."
"Oh, don't hurry," said the Commodore hastily. "Between old friends, but I say by Jove, you are looking well. Never saw you looking so young and charming."
"Never."
It was rather crudely done, but the Commodore could say things more bluntly than other people and get away with them. He was rather a privileged character. Bob began to breathe hard, having a foretaste of what was to follow. And Mrs. Willie Ralston was Miss Gwendolyn Gerald's aunt. No doubt that young lady was up in her aunt's box at this moment.
"Never," repeated the Commodore.
"E.H. Bob? Doesn't look a day over 30, with a jovial, free-hearted sailor laugh.
Does she now?"
It had come. That first test. And the question had to be answered. The lady was looking at Bob. They were all waiting. A fraction of a second or so, which seemed like a geological epoch, Bob hesitated. He had to reply, and yet being a gentleman, how could he? No matter what it cost him, he would simply have to lie like a gentleman. He. Suddenly an idea shot through his befuddled brain. Maybe Mrs. Ralston wouldn't know what he said, if he? She had been numerous times to France, of course, but she was not mentally a heavy weight. Languages might not be her forte. Presumably she had all she could do to chatter in English. Bob didn't know much French himself. He would take a chance on her, however. He made a bow which was Chesterfieldian and incidentally made answer, rattling it off with the swiftness of a boulevardier. "Il me faut dire que vraiment, Madame Ralston pourrait aussi agiquelle. I am obliged to say that Mrs. Ralston appears as old as she is." Then he straightened, as if he had just delivered a stunning compliment.
"Merci."
The lady smiled. She also beamed. "How well you speak French, Mr. Bennett." The Commodore nearly exploded. He understood French. Bob expanded, beginning to breathe freely once more. "Language of courtiers and diplomats," he mumbled. Mrs. Ralston shook an admonishing finger at him. "Flatterer," she said, and departed. Whereupon the Commodore leaned weakly against Dickie, while Clarence sank into a chair.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.